Right. You know, it's funny. I feel like a little bit that's been lost in our talking about the issue so much is just the fact that I think Tom's created something that's timeless. But we can talk about that.
Yes. You were just talking about all the different things that were going on in the moment now with the church. You are still in this.
Yeah, you know, I've had a very interesting journey, I think, myself, working on the movie, because I came to it with a fascination for journalism. I mean, I'd just written a movie about journalism. I was interested in what's happened to journalism over the last 15 years, the fact that we've lost so many reporters, so many Metro dailies, what happens when you don't have journalists holding people in authority accountable. And so when Nicole and Bly and Michael and Steve presented me with, you know, the thumbnail of we have the rights to these four reporters and two editors who uncovered the Boston Globe scandal, you know, nice Jewish boy walks into Boston and goes after the Catholic Church, you know, I mean, I was interested for a number of reasons, but I think mostly because I thought there was an opportunity to tell a great story of local journalism of the kind that is perhaps going away. And maybe that would remind people how important that kind of journalism is. Not to mention, you know, I had the sense that it might be just a good yarn. When, you know, I started investigating, interviewing Mike Resendez and then later the other Globe reporters and then interviewing people in the Boston community, it was clear that, you know, this was a great yarn. It was a great detective story. And moreover, that it was a real, very interesting story of complicity and deference, one of sort of looking away, which felt to me more universal than just the Catholic Church, because this is something, you know, that happened at Penn State. This is something that happened, you know, at the BBC with Jimmy Savile. This is something that happened with Bill Cosby. And why do we look away when there are allegations of abuse? Why does a community turn their backs? Because it struck me, we all know the Catholic Church was not a great actor, but what we weren't paying enough attention to was the actors around the Catholic Church, the lawyers, the cops, the journalists. And so that was my entire entry. And yet, in the process of researching the movie, I got to sit down with Joe Crowley and I got to sit down with Phil Saviano. Tom and I had a long dinner with Joe, and Phil and I, we had like this 4-hour dinner. And we used those tapes to construct the scenes around that those guys are in. And we actually gave the script to those guys to give us feedback. Phil was on set with Neil Huff, and we were down at the last minute trying to get this word grooming in, which is a very important word for survivors. Getting the language right, because we wanted to make sure that we wanted to make sure not only that we were doing the journalists right, but we were doing the survivors right. And sort of in the process of getting to know the survivors, I think, I think not unlike the movie, there's an emotional, you can't help but being emotionally pulled by them. And especially when you look over the last 15 years and see that the church hasn't really changed all that much. There's been a lot of talk where there have been strong newspapers and, you know, reporting outlets. They have held the church accountable and they have found this scandal. And where there haven't been strong journalism outlets, they have not. And so I'd say that side of things, you know, trying to push the church to protect kids is something that has become much more important to me. And, you know, it's been really interesting to see over the last several months what's happened in terms of, you know, first we had Cardinal O'Malley in Boston who came in and replaced Cardinal Law come out and say this is a good film. We had Vatican Radio praise the film, which was very surprising to us. We thought the church was going to come after us. They did the opposite. And then even further, you know, two Australian bishops stood up and said every bishop and priest should see this film. You know, the panel on the protection of minors, which is the clergy sex abuse panel at the Vatican, they screened the film at the beginning of their 3-day session a couple weeks ago. And then literally earlier this week, and I'm not going to be able to pronounce his name, but Bishop, it's like Scicluna, it's S-C-I-C-L-U-N-A, who used to be the chief prosecutor for clergy sex abuse cases at the Vatican, who's a bishop out of Malta, said every bishop and cardinal should see this film, and we need to stop. We need to realize that it is important to report as opposed to focus on omerta. And he actually used the word omerta, which has some significance there in Italy. He said we need
every Godfather film,
right? Exactly. And he said we need to be, you know, cut against this code of silence. And you know, while all of that has been happening, which is very exciting, you've also seen, you know, on the other hand, Peter Saunders, who's one of two survivors on this panel, you know, for the protection of minors at the Vatican, was pushed off the panel because he was advocating too hard, because he was saying, you know, they're not doing enough, right? You've also seen that, you know, literally in the last 2 weeks, there was an article about how the guidelines for bishops around the world say that if there is a priest who's accused in your parish, you bishops do not necessarily have to report this to the authorities. It depends on the law where you are, which is a horrible, you know, it's horrible. Of course you need to report it to the authorities. And last, and this just happened yesterday, Cardinal Pell, who's the number three guy at the Vatican, who the Pope put in charge of economy, trying to clean up financial matters in the Vatican, it was leaked that, and the survivors have been saying this for some time, but it was leaked that the Australian police have been investigating him for actually, you know, being part of abuse and grooming minors for abuse, with numerous cases that have been claimed against him. And so, you know, you get the sense that there is this real war within the Vatican of how to handle this, where you have some bishops who are saying, we need to stand up and we need to shine a light on this, we need to do something. And you have other bishops who are saying, no, we're going to keep covering things up, right?
Do you think they just want their privacy to do it, or do you think they just want to keep doing it?
I think that this is a systematic problem. I think that, you know, I think that it's what Richard Sipe says, that it is part and parcel of the system, it is part and parcel of the celibacy requirement. And I think it is, you know, I think it is, unfortunately, one of those large tumors that will be very difficult to cut out. And I think the reason that, my guess is, the reason why Francis and other popes before him haven't acted even more aggressively is because to hold prelates accountable would be to hold a large number of them accountable. Because I think a large number of them are involved in some level of cover-up. But that said, I think that until they take those dramatic steps and do that, I think it's going to be hard for people to trust the church. But, you know, all of this is to say, you know, it's funny. I think, you know, we worked very hard on the script to make it accessible, to make it something that would be entertaining as well as provocative, to make it just a great, great film. And I think that Tom worked very hard as a director to do the same. And I think he succeeded. I think, you know, I'd like to think this movie is both timely and timeless. I'd like to think not only is it about, you know, thought-provoking issues, but it's a fun watch. You know, who doesn't like spending time with Mike and Robbie and Sasha and Matt? Not to mention Marty and Ben. And if you like them on screen, the real guys are even better, as you know. You know, I'd like to think we've created something that will last. But I also would like to think we've created something that will continue to push this conversation and will, you know, and that will help the world look to the Vatican and say, guys, fix it. Fix it.
So when you were growing up and looking at your computer, thinking about writing things, did it occur to you that you would, I mean, you have this now, Julian Assange, is a controversial figure. I mean, did you think you'd be diving into the middle of such social issues in our future?
It's funny. I came to writing pretty late. I went to grad school first. I was in law school. And, as I was finishing up law school, I was trying to figure out what to do. And I was thinking about politics, but I wasn't really thrilled about where our politics were headed. And
you obviously knew something because it's been a hell of a year.
Exactly. This was a long time ago, but I think the seeds were there. I had also started writing, and I was actually, oddly enough, working on a children's novel because I had done some internships at Children's Television Workshop and Disney Channel. And I thought, oh, these guys are creating entertainment that is actually also, serving an interesting purpose from a educational standpoint. And it was right around that time that The West Wing came on the air, and I loved the show. And I saw that Aaron Sorkin was having this dialogue with the American public on a weekly basis, mm-hmm. and primarily he was entertaining, but also he would tell you the three most important interesting things about mandatory minimums, or tell you the three most important interesting things about campaign finance reform. Mm-hmm. And it was a way to both entertain and also create conversation. And I was just, like a moth to flame,
So just to be obscure and weird about this, was that part of the Bible or did you figure that out watching the show? It was like the three, that was one of the hooks of the show.
It was for me, it was a hook. I mean, I don't know if that was his intent. In fact, there's this great episode where Laura Dern, because I was a fan, I actually wound up working for the show, but after Aaron left, and I was a fan much before I ever started working for the show. There's this great episode where Laura Dern comes on and plays the U.S. Poet Laureate, and says what I believe Aaron was trying to say, which is, I write things to entertain. If they happen to do something else, well, that's coincidence, which I think was always Aaron's perspective. That said, I'm not sure, he's not trying to provoke conversation. I'm probably a little, I'm slightly more on the, I would like to create stuff that creates conversation. Mm-hmm. But at that point, I was just fascinated with this show and I came out to LA and, to see if I could figure out how to write and see if I could figure out how to do what he was doing, which is to create really entertaining stuff that also creates a conversation.
And did that come easily once you got
in? Not at all. Not at all. I still don't consider myself to be anywhere near Mr. Sorkin or Mr. McCarthy any number of really wonderful writers out there. It was hard because, I remember I was fortunate. Aaron was leaving and John Wells was taking over the West Wing. And I had a little, it's funny, I had a little, I was 114, I was like 114 and a half Flores, right? Mm-hmm. I had a little apartment, room in an apartment that I had sublet from a woman who was dating and later married Lou Wells, who was the line producer on the West Wing and who was John's brother. Mm-hmm. And I came out here and I didn't put that together at first. I was just looking for a place to live and, I had tried to write a screenplay or two and didn't really understand that business, and some friends said, well, write a spec script and maybe you'll get a job in television. And I loved The West Wing, and I wrote a spec script about Israel and Palestine, and I gave it to Lou, and he very kindly gave me a round of notes, and when I was done, passed it on to his brother. He liked it enough to do so. And John read the script and was taking over for Aaron, and I guess thought I had done an okay job handling that topic and brought me in for a meeting. And very kindly hired me.
So clearly hubris is your thing. You're a big show off. You like to talk about yourself.
And well, you're making me talk about myself now.
But I'm watching you blush as you do it.
Well, it's so funny because I really think that I've been really fortunate in that I have had, I spent 8 years in television learning from incredible people. I mean, John is the best showrunner I've ever seen. If and when, hopefully when I ever, go back to television, and if I'm lucky enough to have a chance to run my own show, I will basically be trying to do it exactly as John did. Just incredible showrunner, incredible storyteller. I think if you look at the seasons of The West, the three seasons we did, and I was just a pisher. I mean, I was, you know, I mean, it was really John and Deborah Kahn and Lawrence O'Donnell and Peter Noah. I mean, there were some real hitters in that room. John Segar Young, who I learned a ton from. You know, if you look at that room, you know, the way John Wells structured the storytelling, and you look at those last 3 years, you know, the arcs of those seasons are brilliant. And John was never afraid to make a big decision. Well, what revitalizes the show? Well, maybe, you know, the next president, right? And let's do a real, you know, and now we've got Alan Alda versus Jimmy Smits. I mean, how much fun was that? You know, you know, I'm really proud of the small piece that I contributed, but, you know, to me it was a huge educational experience. You know, the John Wells School of Screenwriting. You know, and I feel like those, and then, you know, from there, you know, I worked for Peter Noah, who's great, who I'd worked with on The West Wing. I worked with Sam Baum, who's a good friend. And Dustin Thomason, who are wonderful writers. I was very lucky all the way along in my television career to consistently be learning. You know, 2 years I spent on Fringe, you know, the style of writing they use in the Bad Robot camp, you know, I mean, the way JJ writes scripts, which filters down through everyone who works, you know, who works on one of his shows, and really it was a Kurtzman Orsi show that they developed with JJ. I learned a ton from that too, like how to write an action sequence, right? You know, the first shot at writing the database montage, right, in Spotlight. You know, the bolds and the underlines. It's from that camp, right? You know, you would never think you'd learn something in Fringe that you'd then apply to a show, to a movie like Spotlight, and yet, you know, I think, you know, I've been very lucky. I've learned a lot at every step along the way, and when I started working in features, I mean, you know, I work with Bill Condon, who's, you know, a wonderful human and a great writer. I mean, he is. If you've ever met Bill, I don't know if you've had the good fortune of it. You know, he's the nicest man alive, right? You know, so I got to learn from him, and then I started working with Tom. And Tom's, you know, the greatest.
Is the act of writing screenplays very different for you than writing television, or...?
I mean, it's a mix, and you know, for me, I would say that the hardest thing when I left television was the solitude, because in television you're working with wonderful folks, you know, whether it's Deborah Kahn or Dave Wilcox or whoever it is who's down the hall. You're like, let me pick your brain, and you generally have a genius like one of those two down the hall who can tell you the right answer. You know, whereas in screenwriting, it's you and yourself. I used to joke, you know, when you're in television, you hate your boss. When you're in features, you hate yourself, right? And I never really hated the boss in television. As you've heard, I loved quite a few of them. But, you know, features, it's really hard because you're all alone. I've been really lucky in that, you know, once you start working with a director, you have a true north. That was the amazing thing about it being that room. And, you know, Deborah and I used to say all the time in that room in The West Wing, John's the true north. Because John would do these great, like, you know, he every outline, every script came in, we'd literally workshop. We'd literally have the whole room contribute. And which was very helpful, but could have been totally confusing if not for true north, which was John. And John would basically say, that's a great idea. Or if he didn't like it, he just wouldn't say anything. And then you knew you didn't have to do it, right? But, like, having a true north like that is just, it's so helpful, you know, when you're trying to create something out of nothing. And so, you know, working with Tom, you know, it was very much a creative collaboration, but at the end of the day, he's the director, right? And he set a clear vision from the beginning, right? I want to go for authenticity. I want to get this right. Because that's what I think will make this different, unique, timeless. And I think his vision was very solid from the beginning. And, it, you know, it filters through. You can see that, you know, we were talking last night at a screening about, you know, the invisibility of the filmmaking. And, you know, on the one hand, it is, and it fades and lets you just participate in the movie. On the other hand, if you look at that last sequence when Robbie and Mike come in, mm-hmm. you know, you're in this wide shot, right? They come into the newsroom, they talk to Linda, right? And then they hear, oh, wait, everybody's down in spotlight. They start moving a little quicker, and it's just a very simple pan, right? Mm-hmm. And then you see Marty in the background as they move out of frame. Like, the way he's using the camera, you know, is brilliant. It's just subtle and invisible. And so, you know, but that vision early on, that was the true north. Mm-hmm. And so in some ways, it's much easier writing, you know, because if you're working alone, you've got to come up with your own true north. And sometimes that's mm-hmm. easy and sometimes that's hard. I'm working on a script right now for Damien Chazelle, and Damien is similarly, you know, a genius. Mm-hmm. And what's remarkable is the clarity of his vision, that vision is, you know, something that makes it much easier because we started working on the pitch for this idea together. Mm-hmm. And so I always knew where I was writing.
It's very interesting that you're working with directors who are writers.
You know,
odd coincidence or
you know,
master plan.
I don't know. I mean, I've had three very good experiences working with directors, Bill, Tom, and now Damien. I love collaboration. I think that might be from my television days. Mm-hmm. You know, I definitely don't think I'm good enough to do it on my own. I think even scripts that, you know, that I've written on my own, right. I don't do it without giving it to my buddy Dusty to read, or my buddy Sam to read, or my friend Heather to read, all of whom are brilliant storytellers yeah. and can give me good feedback and input.
But you could have directors who are just director, not just directors, but they, and it's interesting that you're working with people, all of whom have serious writing credentials as well.
I mean, the thing that was great about Bill and is really great about working with Damien is, you know, Damien knows how to tell a story. So, you know, it's sometimes it's, well, let's adjust the scene or let's adjust that scene. Or it's sometimes it's like, well, what if we do this with this character? Right. And it's, what if you have them do X, Y, Z? Right. And that way it has this effect on our main character. And, you know, and he's basically pitching, you know, the skeleton of a, you know, small little storyline that, you know, over 30 pages, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and that's great because I guess, you know, one would say we speak the same language. I very quickly am like, oh, I know what that is. Mm-hmm. And now let me try to execute what you're saying. And so, you know, it's interesting when you're in television, when you're working on staff, I think one of the realizations for me was I'm not trying to necessarily make the best show. I'm trying to make the best show that the showrunner wants to make. And that's what working for a director is, right? You know, it's a little different because generally you are trying to make the best show, but it's really following a leader, right? And it's something that, I don't know, I like to do.
So did you take away, concerning yourself with Julian's whereabouts this week or that kind of stuff? Did you take away that kind of relationship with that material as you have with this, or is this a singular event for you? The spotlight of experience.
I have a lot of. Here's what I took away from The Fifth Estate. I took away a deep abiding love for journalism. I took away a deep respect for what Julian was trying to do when he created WikiLeaks. I mean, when Julian created WikiLeaks, he was literally trying to solve the same problem that we're talking about. He saw that there was a decrease in reporters, Metro Daily's going out of business. He saw there were less reporters on the ground holding powerful people accountable. And what he wanted WikiLeaks to be was another way, a hack, if you will, to hold powerful people accountable. Here's a way to hold powerful people accountable without all this manpower, right? Mm-hmm. And I think the early work of WikiLeaks was very successful. And then I think later they ran into some issues, which, you know, were issues that, I think they were issues that had to do with some of the contours of WikiLeaks and some of the contours of Julian. I think I was sad the movie didn't connect because... I thought that we were saying something important about the press and about what the press was doing. I think that said, you know, I think people had written a lot about Julian at that point. Mm-hmm. And I think that, you know, in some ways, Snowden was a much better case study for the question of this kind of, this new kind of data dumping, secret spilling. Mm-hmm. And I think if you look at the Edward Snowden case, it's a little more, there's a little more clarity around, you know, because you don't have the personal issues of Julian sort of impinging on the other questions. So I don't know. I think I probably put it to bed oddly when John Oliver interviewed Edward Snowden, which I thought was a brilliant interview and which I thought was even-handed in all the right ways. Where on the one hand, I think he was, you know, amazed at what Snowden had revealed and what that said about our potential security state. And on the other hand, wasn't shy about pushing Snowden on, well, but don't you think it's a problem that some of those revelations might actually hurt the United States' ability to protect its citizens? And so I think that balance is very important, that kind of nuance. And ultimately, like, I'm not sure that it was something we really were able to get at in the movie in a clear way, which was probably, you know, certainly as much the fault of the script as anything else. I would say that, you know, to some degree, to exercise my journalism demons, I wrote this movie with Tom. And, you know, it was a way to, you know, Tom and I early on talked a lot about what's happened to journalism and was that a theme, and we decided that we couldn't really say it out loud because this happened sort of before Google came along and before some of the big things happened. But, you know, I did fight for this one line about, you know, how classifieds, how the internet started taking classifieds away from the journalism business, from the newspaper business, and how that much that was hurting the newspapers, because it's the beginning. It's like the canary in the coal mine. And, you know, I'd like to think that that line, you know, helped, you know, set the stage for the conversation that was had around the film a lot in the fall about where is journalism now. I mean, there were a couple op-eds in the Times. Margaret Sullivan wrote, you know, two successive Sunday pieces on, well, Spotlight's asking, where are we in journalism? Where are we in journalism? And I think, you know, in some ways, you know, what I've taken away from WikiLeaks and this movie, you know, is this question, this larger question of, you know, how are we going to make sure there is local reporting? How are we going to stop the Flint, Michigans of the world, right? There's no accountability journalism in Flint, right? Mm-hmm. The New York Times did an article on Flint, you know, a year ago, and it came and went. But there was nobody on the ground in Flint holding those folks accountable. And when there's nobody there to hold people accountable and there's no reporter tracking down that story, this is what happens. And so, you know, I would say in terms of carrying on my relationship with Julian, that is, I'm fighting for the same things that I think he was fighting for, and that is what I feel strongly about. Is
so your bigger interest floats over both films and the future, and then the issue of the church and child molestation.
That's a new one from this one.
You're carrying.
Yeah. And look, here's the thing. You know, I mean, I think. I feel a little bit like I'm sitting here trying to be like a faux professor. I mean, let me make it clear. I'm a screenwriter, right? You know, and I'm a hack in terms of this sort of knowledge. Hopefully not as a screenwriter, but in terms of like actual intellectual knowledge of this stuff. You know, I'm sure I barely scratched the surface of what real students of journalism and real students of this issue, like Peter Saunders and Richard Seip, have to say. You know, and I'd say the overarching thing for me is, you know, to keep getting better as a writer and keep learning how to work with directors and keep hopefully getting more movies made that engage and entertain and create conversations.
It's funny, like, I think that's part of the question of the moment when it comes to journalism and everything else, is that this idea of, you know, who is a tourist, who is kind of a journalist, who is a serious journalist. I mean, the layers of it have become so blurry, and there's so many people spouting off whatever their degree, you know, this thing with the Pope and Donald Trump yesterday, you know, when you hear on CNN or wherever, CNBC, all of them, the next day, people still kind of misquoting what the Pope said.
Right.
Even though they're the experts who are sitting on the air
right.
filling
right.
our hours.
Right. Right.
You kind of wonder where the hell it's all going.
Right. So this is I think, part of the problem, you know, with journalism. And David Milch has talked much more intelligently about this than I ever could, because he worked as a reporter at the Baltimore Sun. And he's thought about this for a long time. But
David Simon.
Sorry. David Milch is also eloquent and intelligent.
Yes, he is.
I meant David Simon.
I thought you had maybe Hollywood Reporter covering.
No, exactly. Exactly. Oh,
it
God.
Happened.
David Simon has talked about this incredibly eloquently. And, you know, has really talked about how, you know, what we're lacking, what we're missing is the newsroom. And that he moderated this panel for us in D.C., and then he was in this Vulture article. And in both places, he said something to the effect of, some of the best stories I ever covered, we didn't print. Meaning, we held them, right? And then we put them out later. Which you see happen in our movie. You know, they go to Marty and they say, we've got 50 priests. And Marty says, I'm not interested in the number of priests, I'm interested in the system. And Marty had it right. And because they held, mm-hmm. and because they went after the system, they broke a much bigger story than they would have if they had just thrown out a number of priests. Similarly, I think later, because they held and didn't go right ahead with those articles, mm-hmm. you know, that showed that law was, you know, was negligent and absolutely new, and waited till they also had, you know, the 70 priest story to come out 2 weeks later. Mm-hmm. I think that was another reason the story went so big. So the discretion, the judgment in terms of what to print, what not to print, when to hold, when not to hold, and getting it right, the persistence and the dogged you know, not rocket science, but just dogged follow-up mm-hmm. necessary to get it right. I think those are all things which we're trying to get at in the movie.
And getting all of it, I think.
Yeah. I really...
Ironically brings up the David Milch story, but that's a whole other conversation.
Right. but that's right. And, you know, I think it's one of those things that, you know, you see a lot of sloppy journalism these days. And to some degree...
It's quick. You feel bad for the journalist
right.
because it's like clearly they're being pushed to get it out there.
Right.
If it has a headline...
That's right, and you know they don't have the time, right? I mean, at least in the days of the newspaper, you know, when the newspaper was king, you had 24 hours, you know, mm-hmm. or if you were working long form, you had longer. But you know, now, you know, it's 24 seconds, and I think that's a real problem. And I think that you know, it's an odd thing to say, but some of these more established outlets, I think, you know, it would behoove them to slow down. You know, I think part of the if you look at what's going on in our politics and our culture, I think part of the problem is the cacophony, it's just one person shouting and somebody else shouting, and there is not a lot of room for nuance. Mm-hmm. And I think most issues in this world need nuance. Most issues in this world aren't black and white. Even the ones that seem absolutely black and white, I think, aren't black and white. And so...
And readers fill it in. This thing I think writers forget, journalists forget, is that the readers, if you don't have it in the story, will assume things
right.
that you haven't thought about them assuming.
Right.
Which is a little scary, because they usually have it wrong at that point.
Right. Right. You know, and I just I think that's what we're trying to get at, you know, at least up here. Not necessarily in here, mm-hmm. you know, but at least up here in the movie is getting across. Tom said he was always... From his day's work on The Wire, he said he was always quite taken with the blue-collar nature of this work. It's not rocket science. It is about getting it, getting it, getting it, getting it. And you see, I think, you know, the other thing that I think is really pretty powerful in the story, and which we're trying to get at ourselves, is what they're doing on the ground, you know, those reporters, and how Marty is steering that ship. And it is that value of having... And I really do think, you know, one guy can make a difference. Look at what's happened with the Washington Post. It's had a renaissance since Marty got there. And look, it doesn't help that Jeff Bezos is, you know, has thrown a little bit of fuel their way, you know, and they're hiring rather than firing. But, you know, that paper is a competitor of the New York Times, and it wasn't 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. I think there is something to be said for leadership at the top. you know, and then, you know, the hard work down here. And that, I think, speaks a lot to how a newsroom should work. And that's what I think we don't see necessarily so much in the 24-second news cycle and in some of these outlets. So
in all of this, you've been celebrated and are celebrating as you go along. Does it feel frivolous in some way while you're doing it? Is it bittersweet on some level? Or is it, you know, you've done the movie and it has its place and it's creating a change and you should have some time to celebrate?
I think from a creative standpoint, it's hard. It's very hard because, you know, I did my last rewriting on this movie. I mean, we actually went back and did some reshoots. So, you know, and then there were lines here and there in the edit. But I don't know. I mean, we finished the cut, you know, end of last spring, early summer. I think that's June, you know, and so, you know, I mean, I've done writing in terms of responses to certain things and speeches and this and that. But in terms of real creative work, that was done in June. So it's a little odd to continue to be involved with the movie so far away, when you're so far away from the creative work. Mm-hmm. It's funny, I was telling this story about Tom and me. A story I tell quite a bit about Tom and me going up and down up between Boston and New York and researching and debating and breaking the story. And I got a little sad because I haven't done that with Tom in a while. And I'm looking forward to doing it again, and we don't have time to do it. Mm-hmm. So it made me just yearn for, you know, for that, which hopefully will happen, in, you know, again, starting, you know, mid-March. I will say the difference here is I'm certainly proud of the film and certainly hope that it is something that people watch for a long time. I think it's a great story. It was a great story when we uncovered it, regardless of anything we did to tell it. So I think the story says a lot. And so I'm certainly happy to promote the film because I'm proud of it. And also, I think we have been fortunate enough to have a little bit of a platform here to talk about journalism and talk about this issue of clergy sex abuse. And the idea that we might be helping to put just a little bit more pressure on the Vatican to change their ways, the idea that we might be making people more aware so that if they see something like this in their family, in their community, in an institution they're a part of, they raise their hand and don't look away. That feels, I mean, creating conversations like that, that's why I came to LA. Mm-hmm. That's why I wanted to be.
You're the first person who's ever said that sentence, by the way.
What?
I came to LA to create conversations. It's usually the exact opposite.
That's right. That's right.
I came to LA to create fodder. Pay me a lot of money for it.
Exactly. You know, it's funny. I'm an odd bird that way, I guess. But, you know, I saw Aaron creating these conversations out here. And I said, maybe this is a way to create conversations, you know, on a larger scale and get the whole country talking about, you know, important issues that are either on the fringe or in the mainstream. And so in that way, I feel like this has been an opportunity. You know, how could I get, that has at least for me, that part is not frivolous.
But at 5:30 in the morning a few weeks ago, when your name was spoken, a little smile.
Yeah, I mean, look.
A little scream, little noise.
I'm not going to lie. You know, it's hard not to get caught up in it all. And I'm not going to lie. You know, any writer, you know, who comes out here, maybe they don't all have the hope that one day their name is going to be mentioned on that broadcast. But I certainly did, and I didn't sleep through. I woke up and was watching. It's odd, though. I will say, you know, I think with this movie, it's been such a collaboration, you know, from the very beginning with me and Tom, and then all the actors and the crew. And Tom makes things feel familial on set. He's very inclusive. I wasn't in the editing room, but I watched like a dozen cuts, and he always took my notes. I mean, he didn't take my notes, but he always received my notes happily and took some of them. I think I feel a fair amount of ownership in terms of the movie, and so, you know, when I went to bed the night before, I was thinking, well, you know, and I remember talking with my friend Bibi. And saying, well, you know, I think three, and you know, I went to bed and saying, you know, well, if we get four or five, I'll be happy. And so for me, it was, you know, when we got six nominations, and it felt like, okay, right, we are a real contender, and we're going to be able to continue to make some noise, and this is going to be something where we are going to be able to continue to talk about these issues, because, you know, and look. There is, of course, and yes, wow, it's exciting. I got nominated, you know. But, you know, I think in some ways I was as excited by the nominations that came to the crew as a whole. And by the way, not just because of the issues, you know, Tom McCarthy does incredible work. You know, it's incredible editorial work that is, I think somewhat underrated because it's so subtle, but that subtlety is what makes it work. Mm-hmm. I'd say the same thing about Tom's direction. It's beautiful. It's almost invisible the way he, you know, moves the camera and pushes you in a certain way. Not to mention the casting and the performances he gets, you know, from the Rachel McAdams and Michael Keatons of the world, but also from the Eileen Paduas and the Jimmy LeBlancs, who are right out of Boston. Eileen Padua, who plays Nana, you know, Sasha's grandmother, never appeared in film or television. And to get a performance out of her that, you know, that can I have a drink of what glass of water, Sasha, at the end, you know, it's heartbreaking. Mm-hmm. And to have both of those actors working in that scene, when one of them is very experienced, one of them has very little experience, that's incredible. So I was thrilled that they were nominated, you know, and Mark and Rachel, I mean, Rachel blew us away. We couldn't write enough for her. Literally on set, we were consistently writing more to bulk up that character, but also because she was doing such incredible work. And you just wanted to write to it. And Mark is the loveliest man alive. So, you know, it just, it's felt very much like a team sport. And so, you know, I think that's pretty much how I'll be going into next Sunday as well. You know, hoping that the team does pretty well.
But part of you is ready to move on also, a little bit.
I'm excited. I'm excited to, you know, I've been working with Damien, and that has been really a joy. Every hour I spend working with Damien is an hour I'm not checking Gurus of Gold, which is a good thing.
That is a really good thing.
It's been really.
We didn't rank you this week, so there you go.
There you go.
Saved you a little bit of agony. Since we assume you're locked, actually.
Kanahara, poo poo poo, oi. My goodness. Wow. You know how to make a guy uncomfortable. I think I just get more neurotic as this process goes on, which is really saying something given my high level neuroses to begin with. My wife and I just watched Manhattan the other morning, and let me just say Woody Allen has nothing on me. Nothing. You know, I think that has been great. And frankly, I'm looking forward to finding the next thing with Tom. You know, it was such a joy working with him. I learned so much. I'm excited to figure out what we're going to do next. I'm excited to get back to work, as it were.
I think people forget that. I mean, it's funny because you talk about the journalist being, you know, it's a job. You just know you grind it out, you grind it. And I think the same thing is true, really, in the film business. People don't realize, I mean, there's a lot of glamour and there's a lot of money and whatever, but I think people don't realize how much the people that they admire are just working.
You know, it's funny, there was one day last week where I was getting into a suit again, and I literally turned to my wife and I said, I was serious, I was like, I just want to be in a t-shirt and jeans, and all I do, I wear button downs, but I just want to be in, you know, in these clothes in front of the computer, you know, in a dark room alone with, you know, to have, you know, it's almost maddening. I'll go through a script with Damien, and I know it's 2 days of work, and it'll take me 2 weeks because I don't have the time to get to work. And that, you know, for somebody who generally spends most of their time without the phone ringing, without anybody emailing them, you know, alone in a preferably dark room, with my headphones on, blaring opera or classical music or jazz, and with the hat pulled low and staring at the computer, this is all very odd. So.
And the work is very exciting.
And the work is exciting. And it's funny, you know, I don't know, especially when, you know, with Damien, I'm now on rewrites. And it's almost once you've climbed that hill and you're at least, you know, you're not at the top of the mountain, but you're at least at a level where you have a foundation below you. And now you just play with the characters and see what they have to say. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't work. But, you know you're going to rewrite it 100 more times before you get to screen, if you're lucky enough to get to screen. And so there's almost a luxury in that. And that moment is just, it's such a lovely, fun, and especially when you've got a great collaborator like Damien or Tom or Bill, where you're just playing. I mean, and so I think being away from that is challenging.
We're going to have to get you some bad experiences. I feel terrible.
You haven't been
screwed over. You haven't been.
Oh, I had a couple. Early. I had a couple of those.
You did? Okay. I feel better then.
Yeah, but yeah, I'm certainly enjoying. I've been very fortunate.
Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you, sir.
There you go.